should never explore the next level. Level of the whole concept.
Rappers, get on the mic talking about cars and clothes. Sounding like ain't been exposed to the foes, the most disciples. I'm from the state that is ill. The rap son of man rotated down the field to say what I feel. Get it off my bird chest, my word becomes flesh. War going on between the west and the east of the land, sticking on the peace. Grease is the word. Murray slides some pimp oil to me. My lady friend sneaks my beer in the movie. Throw your hands in the air if you the true and living. Beware the new world order, the devil's new religion. Sent my homie to the number two division. Selling bootleg movies. Got my VCR on a Uve, Suve. Be at Fat Tuesdays. Drinking tropical itches. Sitting at a table with sophisticated. Nah, that ain't nothing I would call my mother. Nor do I call every my brother. Gotta have black thought and sort of be like Malik. So don't question a brother to the roots.
Yo,
I get deep.
Into the last era. Your scholarship into the world of politics and mascara. We operate within this artificial opera. I bring hip hop terror like the Fuhrer. The Ace Ventura into the horror. Laboratory labora. Venture beyond the border. I'll structure. Style destroy your whole aura. Plus you're a genitalin arise before your eyes. Immortalize my image in disguise. Deceive the devil in disguise. My music I parenthesize. Represent the wise. Do this B.I. We enterprise. Get no compromise. I'm thinking fast like Rama. Don, I wear your mind. I wear like Alzheimer. I pull a mic about my mama. Big up to Bahama. D.A. A.O. This year we leaving them in trauma. Then after me, I plan to leave behind the legacy or history of the family. The fifth dynasty for humanity. Yeah. To bear witness to this. Thou vow, syllabal, stylist.
You know
yeah.
The time, kid, when you and I burst at war. In your thoughts are core. For what your thoughts are core. Stepping up into a zone you should never explore. The next step or level of me, your whole concept tour. When you and I burst at war. In your thoughts are core. For what your thoughts are core. Stepping up into a zone you should never explore. The next step or level of me, your whole concept tour.
Yo, the general flows kids compose on tablet. Expose how they was averaging they thoughts not rapid. Here comes a hot package through your block like traffic. The rock was tight graphic. Now watch the mic blasting. Shooting at the stars with emphatic rap. Static, see the mirror shatter from thoughts. I'm busting back at it. The lieutenant, the elephant, sipping automatic mic. Ripping Asiatic architects out to havoc. The turn of the century, the planet's like a penitentiary. Exaggerated. The Ginders living highly medicated. I used to love her, now she violated. Hip hop, Holocaust, and camps. Old chefs are concentrated. They outdated and incarcerated. Loved and appreciated. Hated and very debated. For every career created, one's eliminated. And that's the way the balance of yin and yang is related for real.
Swing on in a safari, wild like Haha and Watari. Some let the block their mind if they can see what I see. Get out the city for a sec, be at the places I be. Hey, I'ma be back on the deck, opening businesses and places for you to cash your check. My neck of the woods ain't all good, ain't all bad. You can live in the burbs and still get had. The sad part about it is that your house is on the lake. They trying to move us out, the land we ain't appreciate. But peace we skate, crackers we roll a blade on hate. Call each other cuz, cuz of how we relate. I seen way turn into Cadillacs with dope man plates. Through the wind and blow ups, it's how to communicate. Harmonizing through beepers and reaper. The city got my peoples in a sleeper. Talk is getting cheap.
When you and I verse at war, and your roots are caught for what your thoughts are called. Stepping up into a zone you should never explore. The next step or level of your whole concept tour. When you and I verse at war, and your roots are caught for what your thoughts are called. Stepping up into a zone you should never explore. The next step or level of your whole concept tour. When you and I verse at war, and your roots are caught for what your thoughts are called. Stepping up into a zone you should never explore. The next step or level of your whole concept tour. When you and I verse at war, and your roots are caught for what your thoughts are called. Stepping up into a zone you should never explore. The next step or level of your whole.
Got diapers nailed to the wall, boots filled up with slaw, and heaping balls of leather by the sink. Keep your eyes upon the moon and listen for our yak tune,
for soon we will be shaving at your sink.
On yak yak shaving day.
Bye.
galloping like a log. We come by canoe.
Them horns and all, we slide right up your drain.
Deck shaving day begins when we rub our stubbly chins.
My fellow yaks, tonight is Yaksmas Eve. Time to take to your canoes and let the shaving begin.
This year, it's a very contagious, seditious Christmas. You'll get your favorites.
God rest ye, ladies, gentlemen, let not your faces play. Remember, you might catch COVID upon this Christmas day. Just save us all your whining now. Put this mask on your face, and we'll celebrate with comfort and joy. Won't be annoyed, and we'll celebrate with comfort and joy.
It won't be the holidays without your favorite holiday tunes. Contagious, seditious Christmas. Pardon us this holiday. A very contagious, seditious Christmas. Only from KTEL, wherever records are shredded.
The America of John McCain has no need to be made great again, because America was always great.
Well, hello. Welcome. It's that time again. Matt Connerton, Unleashed, and we are live from the studios of WMNH 95.3 FM in glorious and relatively mild downtown Manchester, New Hampshire. Also on Comcast 97 in Manchester, streaming at WMNHradio.org and on the Facebook. On the Matt Connerton Unleashed Facebook page, it is Tuesday, December 22nd, 2020. And here we are, my friends. Wonderful to have you all with me. Let me give the numbers right at the top, 603-250-6007, if you would like to call, 603-250-6007. You can also send a text to 617-917-4476. If you'd prefer, you can tweet me at Matt Connerton or send an email to matt@mattconnerton.com. And of course, you can always opine and interact in the Facebook live chat. Please give the Facebook page a like if you haven't done so already. We would love that. But the best thing to do, of course, is give us a call at 603-250-6007 on this glorious Tuesday afternoon. By the way, some of you might have been confused about something. I played Yak Shaving Day from the Ren and Stimpy Christmas album. And that is from the, because it's from the Ren and Stimpy Christmas album, it counts as a Christmas song, even though I don't think it actually mentions Christmas, unless Yak Shaving Day falls on the same day as Christmas, which is kind of what my impression is. But so I consider it a Christmas song. I'm not a big fan of Christmas music. I know we have an enormous library of Christmas music here at WMNH 95.3 FM. Which you can hear when the live programming is not on. And so, you know, I'm supportive of that. I try to be a company man, but I personally have not been, let me put it this way. I remember my dad saying this once, and I agreed with him. A little bit goes a long way when it comes to Christmas music. So I think I mentioned the other night on Retro Spectrum Radio with Pauly C, I could only think of a couple of Christmas songs that I genuinely enjoy. One of them is Mistress for Christmas by AC/DC. I've always liked that song. But I'm also a big fan of Yak Shaving Day from the Ren and Stimpy Christmas album. Even though the imagery of it's really disgusting, if you think about it. I don't know. Are you even supposed to shave a yak? Don't they kind of groom themselves? I don't know much about how this all works, my friends. I don't even go out into the woods. I'm terrified of deer ticks, so I'm ignorant to these matters. But I do enjoy the song. We'll say hello to everybody in the Facebook live chat, and then there is much, much, much to get to, as there has been. Literally every day of the Trump presidency, there's always much to get to, so much so that it's difficult to know where to start sometimes. An embarrassment of riches, as we say. But let's see. First, let me show some love to our sponsors, because one of the first people in the Facebook live chat today is from one of our wonderful, wonderful sponsors here at WMNH. The Hop Knot. They're closed today, so don't go there today. That's what I was trying to remember. I was trying to think for a second, wait, what day is it today? Are they open today? No, they're not. Monday and Tuesday is their weekend. But they will be open tomorrow, and trivia night's a big deal at the Hop Knot, by the way. Wednesday nights is trivia night. But they have delicious gourmet pretzels. They have craft beer. They have wine. You can take alcohol. You can order alcohol for carryout, like the beers and stuff. It's pretty cool. That was part of the original stay-at-home order that Sununu ordered back in March of last year, or this year, actually. Wow. All this time distortion between the pandemic and the Trump administration. Even pre-pandemic, I felt like there was a certain time distortion with the Trump administration. Like, it feels to me like he's been president for well over a decade. Anyway, but the Hop Knot in the Brady Sullivan Plaza at 1000 Elm Street, right across the street. I can see them from here. I could wave. Sometimes I'll wave, but not only do they not see it because there's a slight delay, but also they're closed today because it's Tuesday. But they will be open tomorrow, and we're very honored and privileged to have them as a sponsor. They do everything very safely there. The staff is masked at all times. The tables are nice and spread out, and they're very, very clean. They're always cleaning and sanitizing and so on and so forth. So it's a very safe place to go. But you know, you don't have to eat there. You can get your food to go. The Hop Knot in the Brady Sullivan at 1000 Elm Street. But also, I saw Mike Pellepita, first one in the Facebook live chat, from Queen City Cabinetry, another one of our great sponsors here at WMNH. Bring your kitchen to life, as Peter White would say, with Queen City Cabinetry. And Mike is a top fan and a great supporter of all the shows here and of WMNH. Scott Robinson, who is a top fan, is in the Facebook live chat. Scott is asking, when is the entertainment report this week? Scott's always very concerned about the entertainment report brought to us by our good friend. And I'm just going to come right out and say it. He's a personal hero of mine, EZG Eric Gagnon, because one of the things that Eric brings to us in his entertainment report is the Amanda McCarthy tour dates. And apparently According to the Facebook, EZG not only does he have an Amanda McCarthy magnet, but he has also received, and I forget if he purchased it himself or if it was sent to him as a gift, he has a new Katie Dobbins magnet as well. Katie's been on the show before, another very talented singer-songwriter from the area. But so, you know, EZG, I'll tell you, he's living high on the hog, as we used to say back on the farm. I grew up on a farm. That's why I hate the outdoors now and why I'm so afraid of everything. A lot of people don't know that. I grew up around pigs and cows and what else is on a farm? There's like roosters or something. I made all that up. I did not grow up on a farm. My dad did, however, and he was once attacked by geese. Did you know this? Well, I don't expect you to know that about my dad, but did you know that geese, if they get upset, they might attack you? Maybe they attacked him because he was, you know, he was just a little kid at the time. But now, to this day, he has a phobia of geese. It's, you know, you ever eat goose? I tried it once, and quite frankly, I found it horrifying, and I shan't eat it ever again. Oh, my goodness. But, yeah, so EZG will be calling tomorrow afternoon in the 5 p.m. hour with his entertainment report. And we look forward to that. I, as always, whenever I think of EZG's entertainment report, I immediately begin to quiver with anticipation and excitement. And I don't use those words lightly. Actually, I do, but I don't use the word quiver lightly. Excitement and anticipation, I do throw those around a bit loosely, I will admit. Brian Mackey, who is a top fan all the way from Idaho and host of the No More Excuses podcast, as shown on my hat for those watching online. He joins us in the Facebook live chat, says afternoon all. Wayne Noel, who is a top fan all the way from Michigan, says afternoon all. Crap, it's only Tuesday. That's true. It is Tuesday. Let's see. Yep, EZG is in the Facebook live chat as well. Very excited about his entertainment report tomorrow. Says Yahoo! And then there's a dollar sign right before the exclamation point. I think he puts the dollar sign because we all know EZG, he's all about the dollars. He's all about the Benjamins or something. I don't know what he's trying to put across there, really. Probably a typo. And then he puts, oh no, Matt is all alone. And then another dollar sign followed by multiple exclamation points. Yes. Well, yeah, it's going to be a little lonely here for a while between the hours of 4 and 6. You know, if you missed yesterday's show, just very, very briefly, we're going to really tighten things up here on this program. You know, Jenny will be with me some days when she's able to be here. But otherwise, it's just going to be me. If Kenny or Trudy from the Hop Knot wants to come in, you know, they are our sponsor, so we'll certainly you know, show deference there and have them in. But otherwise, we're not having folks in studio with us on my program until such time as both Jenny and I have been vaccinated. Well, first they have to convince us that the vaccine is safe. No, I already have faith that it is. I'm not concerned, but that's not really actually what they have to do is figure out the distribution issues. But I'm going to talk about that later. But yeah, so that's the plan. We're going to keep things kind of tight here during my program, you know, until we're vaccinated. We're just, you know, the numbers are going to spiral over these next few months. It's going to be pretty bad. So we're going to take those precautions, as we say. Matt Zedon, or Zedon, however you say that, that's a new person, I think, in the Facebook live chat, says, is this you singing, Matt? I noticed Mark said that during the Ren and Stimpy song. No, Billy West did the voices on that, I believe. Both voices, all the voices. EZG says, Scrooge in the house. I think he meant Scrooge. Scrooge is in the house. I am a bit of a Scrooge. I'm not a big Christmas guy, especially this year. I think I think if you were to put some sort of quotient on my Christmas spirit, it would be somewhere below zero. It would be a negative. Jenny is in the Facebook live chat. Jenny says, shalom all. Abigail Jem, also in the Facebook live chat, says, good afternoon here to opine. Easy G says, yeah, Texas Mike. So I assume Texas Mike is also in the Facebook live chat, and I just haven't seen him yet. Joe Friday says, hello, Maddie. Happy holidays. I think the Secret Society is going to have to start sending you guys treats. That's very exciting. Now, I have to say, and there are multiple things here that are exciting and intriguing. And while we did establish a few minutes ago, I do throw the word exciting around a bit loosely. Intriguing, I never do. So you can be sure that I mean it. Because not only do we still, some people purport to know or suspect the true identity of Joe Friday. I still don't know the true identity of Joe Friday. We've been teased with finding out the true identity, but I still don't know. But the idea of a secret society sending us treats is quite exciting. And really just the idea that there is a secret society. I like that idea. And it makes me wonder, is this a secret society that I can join? Can I be let in on the secret? Are the sending of the treats, do recipients of the treats get to potentially join the secret society? And I know it's a secret, but if I am being considered for membership, I will need to know at least some details about what I'm getting myself into in joining the secret society. Because if it's a weird sex cult or something, I don't know. You might want to talk to EZG if that's the case, but that's not something I would want to participate in necessarily. Joe Friday says, I'm thinking Pappy's Pizza at some point. Well, you know what? If you're going to send us Pappy's Pizza, then I officially don't care what kind of secret society it is. I am in. And we have a call. Hi, welcome to Matt Connerton Unleashed. Who's this?
Ridley all up in here.
Dave Ridley all up in here, or in the house, as I believe the young people also say. Don't they, Dave Ridley?
That is all. No, I have news.
Oh, okay. Well, we like news. Is it good news, bad news, medium news?
Well, actually, this is bad news.
Okay. Well, you know what, Dave? It's 2020. We're used to bad news. Let her rip.
So are you familiar with the libertarian gubernatorial candidate for New Hampshire, Daryl Perry?
Yeah. Oh, no. Yes. And I, Daryl W. Perry. And I like Daryl very much. So you're about to give me bad news about him.
Yeah, he had a stroke.
Oh, Jesus.
That. So it sounds like from reading his wife or his girlfriend, I don't know which, from reading her posts, it sounds moderate. Doesn't sound severe. Doesn't sound mild. But I don't know all the details. Apparently, he's got some cognitive damage or memory damage or whatnot. But he was back home within a few days, so it couldn't be that severe.
Yeah. I knew he was having, Jenny's in the Facebook live chat. She's not happy to hear this either. She says, OMG, no. Oh, that's terrible. Yeah. I know he's had some health issues. But he's a relatively young guy, right? I mean, how old is Daryl?
Well, I would guess he's about 50.
Is he? He's older than I thought.
Maybe. I don't know. He could be 45. I'm just guessing. Yeah. I've known him for a while. Now, he used to, like in the 2010 era, he was kind of overweight, but then he discovered marathons.
Yeah.
So I kind of figured he, you know, and he really did trim up, and he seemed to be really doing well. Maybe that wasn't enough. I don't know.
Yeah. Wow. Okay.
So he's one of those people that's very passionate and sometimes rubs people the wrong way. But the important thing about him is that he's never been willing to. And there's not very many people like this. He's never been willing to like compromise the idea that you don't steal from people. So he never took a position like, well, yeah, this one government program is really important, and probably it's worth taxing people over it because it's so important. I don't think he would ever say anything like that. It was always about making sure there was no act of aggression. And that has always endeared him to me.
Well, what's endeared him to me is, I mean, he just, you know, he and I probably disagree on a million things, but just a very, very nice guy. Just a sweet guy, you know, and he's a big wrestling fan. So that's something Daryl and I have in common.
Okay.
I don't know if you knew that about him, but yeah. But, that sucks. That's all you know at this point? He had a moderate stroke?
Correct. It sounds like it's moderate.
Okay.
And I haven't been on Facebook in about 5 days, so I've missed the latest details. That's why I was just getting them from his girlfriend on Facebook, or his wife. I don't know if they're married or not.
I think they are, if I'm not mistaken, but okay. I could be wrong. Okay. Right. Well, that's terrible. Well,
yeah.
Well, I hope he recovers. You know, very, very nice guy, and very very smart. Like I said, I mean, you know, he and I definitely disagree on some things, but definitely a good dude. Oh, I hate to hear that.
Well, they say, you know, I'm not religious, but they say that there's actual scientific evidence that praying for someone helps them. So I actually do pray for people when they have problems, despite not being religious. So I would urge that.
Oh my God, Dave, you know what? You saying that is really interesting, and I'll tell you why, because I have done that. Like, I don't believe in like an all-knowing, all-seeing deity that lives in the clouds, but I also I do believe in these other concepts of energy. Like, if you put energy out into the universe, you know, you get something back, and what you get out, you get back and whatnot. And so based on that, I also have done that, even though I'm not necessarily praying to some sort of deity. And I've never said that publicly, that, you know, because it's like, because I you know, people are going to hear that and say, okay, so Matt's basically agnostic, you know, almost an atheist, but he prays. That doesn't make any sense. But you saying that just now, what you just said kind of validates what goes on in my mind that I don't say out loud.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? You're the only other person I've ever heard say anything. Well, actually, I've never heard anyone say anything like that. I thought I was the only one who felt that way. Like, there's probably value in prayer, even if you don't actually believe in quote unquote a God. You know what I mean? I didn't think anyone else really thought that. And then you said that and I'm like, oh, wow. Somebody else does.
You know, it's interesting that as time goes by, we find that the idea of godhood is actually, it's kind of like did you ever see that TV series called The 4400?
I'm aware of it, but I've never actually watched it. I'm aware of the show.
These people, this is a little bit of a spoiler here, so put your hands over your ears if you can't get to the radio. But, you know, it's sort of... you know, these people come back from the future. All these people that were thought to have died in the past, they come back.
Okay.
They're sort of sent back by people in the future, basically. The future is messing with the past, sort of. But as you move further forward in time, it starts looking more and more like this future that the people are coming back from, right?
Okay.
So it's the same way with the concept of a god. So the Greek ideas of creatures being able to do all these miraculous things, and the Christian idea, you know, of an all-knowing God and so forth. As time moves forward, it seems like things feel more godlike, right? Like things that people can do right now are somewhat godlike, and things that people will probably be able to do in 50 years could literally be godlike. So this is kind of like Ray Kurzweil said, there's not much evidence for a God existing right now, but there is a lot of evidence that one could be created.
Yes, this is a familiar concept, because we talked about it. You brought something like this up before, I think, a few months ago. You had called in about something that's being developed that, did it have something to do with AI and AI so advanced that I don't remember exactly what, but it was something really interesting you had said about how there could eventually be someone with godlike powers, or something, not a human, but something AI related with godlike powers that may decide to destroy us or something. It was something along those lines. I don't remember exactly what it was, but
right, that's apparently in the works.
Okay.
So, of course, that, you know, and then there's also the theory that, you know, that could have been in the works many, you know, thousands of years ago somewhere else. And, it, you know, someone else could have created something like that a long time ago. And maybe someone created something like that outside our universe, or maybe someone created our universe. It's really not hard to jump from possibility to possibility.
Oh, sure. Absolutely. Absolutely. And now, you know, the government is very, very slowly, they're wading into it, but they're acknowledging more and more that there's, you know, these spacecraft or whatever that seem to be out there. Maybe, you know, and there is a longstanding theory that, you know, that we, you know, that maybe God is actually aliens, that, you know, and that we're the offspring of aliens. I mean, it's a whole, there's all these different rabbit holes you can go down, but,
well, we just did.
Yeah. Wow. All right. Well, that's interesting. I'm just glad you said that, Dave. I've never quite heard anyone say it the way that you said what you said. Makes me feel like I'm a little less, nuts. Maybe I'm not crazy for thinking what I think. Very, very interesting. Well, you know what? And I will today I will I'll say a prayer for Daryl W. Perry.
Yeah.
It certainly can't hurt. All right, Dave. Well, wow. Well, that got deep. Anything else on your mind?
That is all.
All right, Dave. Well, thank you for the call, my friend. And please give the Ridley Report a plug before you go.
RidleyReport.com. I ambush interview politicians.
All right, very good. All right, Dave, thank you so much for the call, my friend. And have a great, if we don't talk to you, if we don't get a chance to talk to you again this week, have a great holidays. And we'll talk to you next year, technically, if not sooner.
Okay.
All right, Dave.
Are you off all the way from Christmas to New Year?
Correct. Yeah, this year we are. They're gonna close the station down. I think they're gonna do a deep cleaning because of COVID.
Okay.
So yeah, I'll be on up through Christmas Eve and then off until January 4th.
Okay.
But maybe we'll talk before then. Who knows? That's really up to you if you call or not. But regardless, have a great holidays.
All right. You too, Matt. Merry Christmas.
All right, Dave. You got it. Merry Christmas. Bye
bye.
All right, Dave Ridley from the Ridley Report. Wow, that went a direction. Jeez. Actually, it almost went, for a second there, I was afraid it was going to go a direction. I thought he was going to tell me something even worse about Daryl Perry, because I was aware that he had had some health issues, but geez, that's terrible that he's had a stroke. Daryl, for those who aren't familiar with him, Daryl's a pretty strict libertarian. He used to be one of the hosts on the syndicated show Free Talk Live, along with Ian Freeman and Mark Edge. But I think he left that. I think he left that behind a long time, well, not a long time ago, a little while ago. And then he ran for this past election. He was the libertarian candidate for governor here in New Hampshire. So if you're in New Hampshire and you're thinking, that name's kind of familiar, but I'm not sure where I know it from, you may have seen him on your ballot. So, but yeah, Daryl's a really nice guy. So that's terrible to hear. I hope he recovers. Wow. All right. Well, that does open up a line for you. If you'd like to join us, 603-250-6007, 603-250-6007. You can also text us at 617-917-4476. Tweet me at Matt Connerton, or you can send an email to matt@mattconnerton.com. But the best thing to do is call us, 603-250-6007. Let's see. Rocky Huber, who is a top fan, is in the Facebook live chat. Rocky says, hey, did anyone else catch Easy G's live stream on his trip to Target? Jenny and I saw a part of a live stream that he did. I don't know if it was to Target or I don't know. I think it was to Market Basket. Easy G loves Christmas music all day long. Oh, boy. Angela Philbrook is in the Facebook live chat. Hello, Angela. Miriam Banish is a top fan in the Facebook live chat. She says, very low-key Christmas stuff happening here, but working with kids makes it easier to get into the spirit of the holiday. Well, that's good. Eric Street is a top fan. Eric says, it's nice you can see the City Plaza and the Brady Sullivan Plaza from Target. Oh, no. Easy G says, I erased the Target video. Oh. Joe Friday says, the Secret Society, it's like a Secret Santa. Oh, it's a Secret Santa sex cult. Jenny says, I want to covet Peter's popcorn. Yeah, that container of popcorn is still here. It's like the only thing that's still here from the Miracle on Elm Street is this canister of popcorn. And I almost wonder, I should ask the giant cardboard Peter Whitehead in the corner if the human Peter White is because he probably knows I love popcorn, and he's leaving that here to taunt me. Every day it taunts me. Actually, I try not to eat popcorn anymore. Abigail Jem says she's in the Secret Society. Oh, so you've had Pappy's Pizza. Great. When do I get mine? Gonzo is in the Facebook live chat. Gonzo says, Matt, be very cautious with the Friday Society. Gonzo knows something about this. Joe Friday says to Mike, you are a legacy in the society. Once you are in, there is no getting out. Welcome, sir. Oh, my goodness. Bobby Champagne, who is a top fan, joins us, says good afternoon. Jenny says, in my book, that is meditation. That's referring to my discussion about prayer with Dave Ridley. I never expect to really say that on the air. But, prayer is certainly a form of meditation. Angela Philbrook says, glad today was the last day for my husband. Already anxious about people being dishonest when he goes back regarding their possible COVID-19 exposure. Rocky says, hey, Matt, I'm the same way. The power in prayer lies in the energy that's put. Hey, funny you mention it. The Dalai Lama was added to the COVID bill. Check it out. The Dalai Lama. Bobby Champagne says, is popcorn a food group? Gonzo says, my father tried to leave the society, now a studio ghost. Well, you know, I did just feel a terrible chill come over me. Tom Blanchard is in the Facebook live chat. Tom says, just getting in. Hello, everyone. Joe Friday says, Gonzo, the society will protect you. Don't be afraid of the mask. Oh, my goodness. Wow. And Mary LeMay joins us in the Facebook live chat. Hello, Mary. By the way, I want to thank Mary for this wonderful card. So yesterday during the show, Mary brought in this card and handed it to Jenny. It was in an envelope, and we left it for Peter White to open on the morning show because, you know, it was addressed to WMNH, and Peter's not only the morning show host but the program director here, so we figured we'd leave it to him to open. Although we probably could have opened it because our names are first. It says, wishing for a very Merry Christmas and Happy New Year to Matt Connerton, Unleashed, Jenny Coffee, and Peter White in the morning, WMNH 95.3, God bless, from Cruising with Mary on Channel 23. So thank you for that, Mary. Very, very nice surprise. Thank you. Joe Friday says, by the way, Bobby Champagne is in the society, as is Jeff Nyhan and Pat Mills. What are you guys all sitting around eating Pappy's pizza together? I'm so jealous. All right. Well, let's see. So we have some interesting things to get to, my friends. Something occurred to me. I realized something that so on January 6th, that is when the Congress will certify the election. That's the next big step in the process of vice president elect, or I should say president elect. He used to be the vice president. I created an amalgam of, you know, because he was Vice President Biden and now he's the president elect. So Kamala Harris is the vice president elect. President elect Joe Biden, you know, the next step in his ascendance to the presidency on his way to Inauguration Day, when he will legally become the next president of the United States. The next big step in this, now that the Electoral College last week certified the election, now Congress has to do their part. They will certify the election in Congress. And, you know, I assume... I mean, when the Electoral College certified the election, people said, well, you know, that's it. Now it's official. You know, now there's definitely, you know, Trump has to accept it. And of course, Trump continues to not accept the results of the election and he still will not concede and so on and so forth. And, you know, I've been predicting all along he will not be at the inauguration. Certainly, he'll probably be in Mar-a-Lago pouting, whatever. Although apparently, too, there are MAGA people who are organizing an online inauguration for Trump's second term. Have at it. Have at it. But what I did not realize, and I knew this in the back of my mind, but I hadn't really thought about it. What happens when Congress certifies the presidential election? What happens on that day? The vice president presides over that. The vice president has to be there to preside over it. Well, the vice president is Mike Pence. And Mike Pence, of course, is currently... I would love to know what goes on in that man's mind. What he knows. Mike Pence knows this is all folly. There's no overturning the election, but as far as we know, Mike Pence is, you know, he's in the room for these meetings with these other people who are trying to help convince Trump that he can still win. But what happens? See, this adds a delicious bit of drama to the whole thing that I hadn't considered. What does Mike Pence do on January 6th? That's hard for me to say. S-I-X-T-H. The X-T-H letter combination is difficult. I probably won't attempt that again. I'll just say January 6th, not January 6th. But what does Mike Pence do? This is his constitutional obligation, is it not? Does Mike Pence go and refuse to certify Joe Biden? Do the... you know, these charlatan so-called attorneys who are trying to trying to help. I forget her name now. That one attorney who was fired and then rehired by Trump or something. Not Jenna Ellis. The other one. Her name escapes me. But I mean, is there some way that Mike Pence can refuse to certify, thus delaying? And if he does refuse to certify, will there be an argument made that he's not constitutionally bound to do that? And if he then refuses to certify, does that somehow push everything off and delay everything? Or can someone else certify if he refuses? What happens? What does Mike Pence do? But when I say I'd like to know what goes on in his mind is, the thing about Mike Pence, if you watch him very carefully, I've always felt this. I felt this about him from the beginning. He just looks like a guy. Maybe it's his natural default expression, his facial expression, but he just looks to me like a guy who knows something. I always think that when I look at Mike Pence. Well, actually, I think one of two things when I look at Mike Pence. One of them is I think he looks like a guy who knows something. You look at him and you know that guy knows more than he says, right? So, you know, is he... What is he thinking? I would just be curious to know, what is he thinking? Is he thinking, has he somehow convinced himself that God speaks to him and has told him that you know, he must figure out a way to rescue the Trump presidency because it's God's will, you know? Or is he thinking, I'm going to go through the motions of this? And by the way, this is what I think is probably the case. Is he thinking, I'm going to go through the motions of this whole thing because the Republican Party is Trump's party now, so I have to look like I'm sticking by him no matter what so that I can run for president in 2024. That's assuming Trump doesn't run. But the other thing I always notice about Pence is I think one of two things. He looks like someone who knows something that he's not saying, right? Or he looks like someone who's just deeply in love with his boss. And I don't mean that. I don't mean it that way, you know, because God would obviously be very angry with him if he had those kind of thoughts. I just mean more in the same way that most Trump supporters are in love with President Trump. And because if you look at the way Pence looks at Trump whenever Trump is talking, it's just the adoration and the love in Trump's face. I mean, he's just beaming whenever he's gazing upon Trump talking. One of the political satirists who, you know, sometimes I play some of her songs to open the show, Lauren Mayer, she wrote this one song. What was it called? Something about the way Pence looks at Trump. And the song, the lyrics to the song, maybe I'll try to find it and play it during the break. But basically the song is about how she wishes that she had a partner who looked at her the same way Pence looks at Trump. But so what does Pence do? And if Pence goes and does do what he's, I believe, constitutionally required to do and certifies that Joe Biden is president-elect and thus codifies what the Electoral College has already certified, then at that point, doesn't he officially become a traitor to President Trump? And if Trump perceives that Pence has turned on him and therefore that causes Trump to turn on Pence, doesn't that effectively end Pence's political career? Because, you know, we've seen over the last 4 years how it works generally. Now, there are exceptions like Tom Blanchard, for example. He's in the Facebook live chat. Tom has expressed his frustration with Trump. He's a, you know, he likes Trump, but he's angry with him because Trump won't just concede the election and move on. But most Republicans, and polling data shows this, most Republicans have said they're going to stick with Trump no matter what. They believe he actually won the election. I saw one poll that shows 70% of Republicans believe that Biden stole the election from Trump. So this is still very much Trump's party. And we've seen what happens. It's very much like high school. Trump is the captain of the football team. He's the most popular kid in the popular crowd. And if Trump decides he doesn't like somebody, if the captain of the football team decides, you know, I don't like that kid. I don't like that kid. I don't want him sitting at our lunch table anymore. The entire Republican Party then says, okay, well, we don't like him either because, you know, the captain of the football team doesn't like him. You know, and we want to continue to be in the in crowd. That's the modern Republican Party. Yes, it really is that childish, in my opinion. I mean, look at what happened to John McCain. John McCain was a war hero, right? To a lot of people, certainly to Republicans. And then Trump came along and put him down and expressed his displeasure with John McCain, saying, oh, he's not a war hero. He was captured, blah, blah. And then, you know, it seemed like virtually every Republican in the country, all of a sudden I see all these Republicans going on. Because at the time when Trump made that comment, people were like, oh my God, I can't believe Trump would say that about John McCain. Trump may have just ended his run for the presidency with that one comment. And instead, all of a sudden on Fox News and everywhere, all these Republicans are going on saying, yeah, we don't like John McCain either. John McCain's terrible. John McCain's he's not a war hero. He's a war criminal. Right? The entire Republican Party all of a sudden hated John McCain just because Trump said, I hate that guy. So Pence is really, and please don't anyone mistake my observation as any sort of sympathy or empathy for Mike Pence. It's not that. But I do recognize he's in an impossible position. What does Mike Pence do? If he does what he's supposed to do, he's a traitor to Trump. And that's it. Because Trump's not going away. I mean, it is, you know, Chris Cuomo calls them, he doesn't even call them Republicans anymore. He calls them Retrumplicans, which I get what Cuomo's doing there. It's a little clumsy, I think, but a little forced, but okay. But it just makes the point. I mean, it is Trump's party. You know, usually by now, in fact, come to think of it, usually at this point, once we know who the president-elect is, once we're, you know, only a month out from the inauguration, you already begin to see the field begin to congeal, so to speak, for 2024, right? You already see, you're not going to see that with the Democrats in this particular cycle, obviously, because, you know, Joe Biden will presumably run for re-election, although maybe not, and maybe it'll be Kamala running. But regardless, you know, we already know what the future holds for the Democrats. But for the Republicans, in theory, you would see in a normal cycle, you would see a lot of talk in media about, well, who are the potential Republican candidates for 2024? Who's going to start to move into position and start fundraising and start going on media and saying, you know, no one's going to announce this early. But normally you'd see some of these prospective candidates engaging the media and being very coy about, yeah, you know, I'm not saying I'm going to run, but I'm not saying I'm not. But you don't see any of that this time. You don't see anybody doing that. Nobody. Why? Because they all think Trump's going to run in 2024. And if he does, or if he even threatens to, that freezes the entire Republican field because this is still Trump's party. If Trump runs in 2024, Trump will be the nominee. Trump will be the Republican nominee in 2024. He just will. I mean, Republicans loved Reagan, but their love of Trump is deeper than anything I've seen in my lifetime. I mean, he is their savior. So anybody who goes against Trump, that's why they're all so terrified. That's why that's why it took Mitch McConnell as long as it did to finally say that Joe Biden is the president-elect. That's why Lindsey Graham, Miss Lindsey of South Carolina, that's why he's still, even now, and Joe Biden used to be one of his best friends. They were buddies. But Lindsey Graham, even now, is saying things like, well, I don't know if Joe Biden's going to be the next president. I don't know. We got to wait and see. Because they're all terrified. Because they know if they say anything against Trump. So they all have to. And this is why I mean, I have no respect for the Republican Party at all at this point. I mean, the spinelessness, the cowardice of these people is incredible. They have to continue to placate the ego of this man baby. All because, and people get it wrong. People always say, all because they're so afraid of Trump, but it's not Trump they're afraid of. It's the Republican base. They're not actually afraid of Trump, but they're afraid if Trump makes a mean tweet about someone and gives them an insulting nickname. Now the base is going to say, oh, Again, it's just like high school. Oh, captain of the football team doesn't like that guy anymore. Well, now I don't like him either. So Mike Pence's political future may end on January 6th, because if he does what I believe, if I'm not mistaken, he is constitutionally required to do, that's it. Trump's going to lash out at him. He's going to say Pence betrayed him. Pence is done. Pence will never be president. Pence will never be the Republican nominee. Pence's career is over at that moment. I'm not complaining about it. It's like, I feel like I'm, you know, it must be that feeling some people get when they watch their enemies just destroy each other. I mean, I think it's fun, but as you can probably tell, I'm enjoying all this very much. But it didn't occur to me until today. I was like, wait a minute. Oh, my God. Mike Pence is the one who has to preside over this. And you know what made me think about it was somebody mentioned Al Gore. Now, in 2000, in the year 2000, Conan fans will know the reference. but in 2000, George W. Bush versus Vice President Al Gore, when the Supreme Court intervened and told the state of Florida, oh, yeah, counting all those votes. Yeah, never mind that. You don't have to do that. Don't worry about it. We're just going to, it'll be Bush. It's fine. We're all good. When the Supreme Court did that, and George W. Bush became the nominee, I mean, not the nominee, the president-elect, Al Gore, he was the sitting vice president. He had no choice. He had to go and preside over the certification of his rival, George W. Bush, for the presidency. Now, what did Al Gore do? Did he pitch a fit? Did he not show up? Did he? No. There was a moment, and I'm going to play the audio in case you've never heard it or in case you want to relive it or, you know, I'm curious. I remember this moment vividly. There is a moment during the certification, and I've got this is from the Associated Press, this audio that I'm going to play. It's like a kind of a wrap up of the certification. But when Al Gore had to go and preside over the certification of his rival winning the presidency, somebody said, it was somebody from the Congressional Black Caucus, and I think it might have been Maxine Waters because she's been there forever. But somebody said there was a lot of anger. There was anger among Democrats who felt like the Supreme Court was wrong to intervene and they should have let the vote count in Florida continue. Remember, I mean, you know, those of you who are old enough to remember, of course, the hanging chads and all that. And there was also, you know, the frustration with the Electoral College because it appeared at the time that and how this ultimately ends up mathematically kind of depends on who you ask. But it did appear at the time that regardless of how Florida was turning out, that Gore did have the edge in the popular vote. So there were there was this moment. Actually, I'll just play it for you. I'll play it for you. But here's what we got. So there's some. This is, I might have to move this forward a little bit. So everybody
certified today.
Here we go.
Mr. President, there are many Americans who still believe that the results we are going to certify today are illegitimate.
So this is different Democrats. What you're hearing, the clip's only a couple minutes in total, but what you're hearing at this point in the clip is these Democrats getting up and saying, at the certification that, you know, we believe that this is this election was illegitimate.
And Mr. President, the certificate of the electoral vote of the state of Florida seems to be regular and informed and authentic and appears therefore and therefrom that George W. Bush of the state of Texas received 25 votes for president and Dick Cheney of the state of Wyoming received 25 votes for vice president.
By a member of the House of Representatives and by a senator.
I must object because of the overwhelming evidence of official misconduct, deliberate fraud,
and an attempt to suppress voter turnout. The chair must remind members that under Section 18...
So what's happening there is, so you're hearing Democrats get up and say, you know, I must object to this because there's a problem here. And then you hear Al Gore, Vice President Al Gore, again, as he's presiding over the certification of his rival to become president-elect officially, legally, Al Gore, that's Al Gore hitting the gavel saying, no, you can't object to this. You're not allowed to because this is the process. And yeah, I lost and it sucks, but it is what it is. And, you know, we can't stand here all day and listen to these objections. And that's why Gore is hitting the gavel, even though, you know, and as a person of empathy, I can only imagine it must have been killing him inside. It must have been just heart-wrenching to have to be there and do this. And here are members of his own party getting up and speaking on his behalf. And he's got to be the adult in the room and conduct himself as a statesman and say, no, this is the legal process and we have to proceed, even though we hate it, even though it's killing me inside because I thought I was going to be president, but I'm not. And this is what we have to do.
Of Title III.
Mr. Vice President, there are gross violations of the Voting Rights Act from Florida.
And
it is not signed by a senator.
Gentleman from Illinois, Mr. Jackson, arise.
Well, Mr. President, I am objecting to the idea that votes in Florida were not counted. And it's a sad day in America, Mr. President, when we can't find a senator to sign
the
these objections.
New gentleman will suspend.
Won't sign objections, Mr.
And here and after referred.
By the way, so the applause that you hear there is a large number of Democrats leaving the chambers in protest. And again, they're doing this on behalf of Al Gore, in support of Al Gore, but Al Gore, as is constitutionally required, is doing what he has to do and is continuing the proceeding.
And this certificate of the 2000...
The whole number of the electors appointed to vote for President of the United States is 538, of which a majority is 270. George W. Bush of the state of Texas has received for President of the United States 271 votes. Al Gore of the state of Tennessee has received 266 votes. This announcement of the state of the vote by the President of the Senate shall be deemed a sufficient declaration of the persons elected President and Vice President of the United States, each for the term beginning on the 20th day of January 2001, and shall be entered, together with a list of the votes, on the journals of the Senate and the House of Representatives. May God bless our new President and our new Vice President, and may God bless the United States of America.
So there you go. That's what Al Gore had to do. So is that what Mike Pence has to do? Does Mike Pence simply show up and do what Al Gore had to do 20 years ago and, as is constitutionally required, certify the results for Joe Biden and Kamala Harris? Or do they pull something? And I don't know what they could. I don't know what else they could do. But that's going to be fascinating. January 6th is going to be one of the most fascinating days in this entire process. Because for once in his life, Mike Pence will be genuinely interesting. No, I'm being snarky about it, but But it will be a very interesting moment to see what Mike Pence does. We need to hit a break in a moment, but I do want to catch up on the Facebook live chat comments because there is a lot going on in the Facebook live chat. And then we will take a break. Bobby Champagne was suggesting maybe a huge tug of war contest on the White House front lawn. Yeah, I mean, if who would win Biden versus Trump in a tug of war? I think probably Trump. I mean, Biden's in better physical condition, but I think Trump probably has more upper body strength. Jenny just shared an article in the Facebook live chat. So I just clicked the link, but it looks like it's relevant to what we're discussing. But we'll come back to that. Now everything's taking forever to load because that's how Facebook has been for me lately. Maybe we'll come back to that after the break. Yeah, let's do that. We'll come back to that after the break. We'll play a couple things here. So you are tuned in to Matt Connerton Unleashed. We are live. We only have after today. Today's Tuesday. So after today, we only have two more shows of 2020. But yeah, only two more shows of 2020. And then we'll be on break and then coming back January 4th. But we are live from the studios of WMNH 95.3 FM. Let's play something. And we'll talk at y'all again in a minute. Welcome back, everybody. We are well into hour number two, numero dos of Matt Connerton Unleashed, and we are live on WMNH 95.3 FM in glorious downtown Manchester, New Hampshire, and on Comcast 97 if you're in Manchester, streaming at WMNHradio.org, and on the Facebook, on the Matt Connerton Unleashed Facebook page. It is Tuesday, December 22nd. 2020. If you'd like to get in with the call, we'd love to hear from you. Do it soon because we're here today till 6. We've got tomorrow and Thursday, and then that's it for 2020, and then we're off until January 4 is when we'll be returning. So give us a call, 603-250-6007, 603-250-6007. Of course, you can also send a text to 617-917-4476. Tweet me at Matt Connerton or send an email to matt@mattconnerton.com. And of course, I'll remind you, we are proudly sponsored by the Hop Knot in the Brady Sullivan Plaza at 1000 Elm Street. They're closed today. Monday and Tuesday is their weekend, but they'll be open tomorrow. And, of course, Wednesday nights is trivia night, and they have delicious gourmet pretzels, they have craft beer, they have wine, they have soups. It's that time of year. They have delicious soup. So all kinds of great stuff at the Hop Knot, and we're very honored and privileged to have them as a sponsor. Please support your local businesses, especially, you know, restaurants that are, you know, really having such a terrible time during this ongoing pandemic. We have that article that Jenny shared in the Facebook live chat. This is from thehill.com. It says, Pence may leave for overseas trip after certifying vote. You know, before the break, we were talking about what does Mike Pence do? How does he handle that on January 6th when he has to certify the vote for, you know, making Joe Biden legally the president-elect? It says here, Vice President Pence is reportedly planning to leave for a foreign trip after confirming President-elect Joe Biden's win on January 6th. Three U.S. officials told Politico that Pence is considering a week-long overseas trip that would begin on January 6th, the day he is expected to confirm Biden's win and his ticket's loss in the presidential election. The vote places Pence in an awkward spot, given Trump's refusal to concede the race. Pence's job is largely ceremonial, but his constitutional duty is to confirm the winner of the election. He's far from the first vice president to be placed in an uncomfortable spot. Perhaps most notably, and I played the audio earlier, former Vice President Al Gore declared Republican George W. Bush as the president-elect in early 2001 after he lost the election to Bush while winning the popular vote. The Bush-Gore fight ended up being decided by the Supreme Court, which upheld the count for Bush in Florida. Leaving the country could allow Pence to avoid the ire of Trump and his supporters. Pence aides did not confirm the trip to Politico, but the news outlet obtained documents that showed Pence's itinerary with plans to stop in Bahrain, Israel, and Poland. According to Politico, a pre-advanced team has already left to visit the planned stops to prepare for his international tour. This will be Pence's first international trip since January, where he traveled to Rome and Israel. One senior official said the trip was not confirmed yet and said the timing had to do with how his schedule lined up. Yeah, sure. I suspect the timing is anything but coincidental, a Pence ally told Politico. So there you go. I think Pence just wants just wants one last ride on Air Force Two. Maybe that's it. Maybe that's it. Let's see. We'll say hello again to everybody in the Facebook live chat. There's talk in the Facebook live chat about the relief package or stimulus package, but it really does nothing to stimulate the economy. We talked about that a lot on the show yesterday, actually. Bobby Champagne says, by the way, I often wonder what kind of president Al Gore would have made. I don't know. I mean, I assume Al Gore wouldn't have gotten us into Iraq and Afghanistan, but who really knows? Let's see. There's I'm going to kind of skip over some of this, but Tom Blanchard says, I wonder how many senators become millionaires while in office. Probably quite a few, quite a few. Jenny says, OMG, LOL, it's Infusion Day. I get to wake up to a new world order on January 6th. Oh, looks like they're negotiating the they're negotiating their own stimulus in the Facebook live chat. We have a call. Let's grab this. Hi, welcome to Matt Connerton Unleashed. Who's this?
Easy G.
Easy G, Eric Gagnon. How are you, my friend? How is your platonic significant other, Heidi?
She seems to be doing fine.
Okay, well, okay. How are you?
Not too bad. The that crazy guy Clyde Lewis, he had everybody jumping scared the other day. My father said it's total BS. The he had people on his show the other day saying we have to worry about other countries taking over our power grid and everything will be shut off and it'll be the end of the world.
Oh my
God! Have you heard that before?
I haven't heard that specifically before, but that clearly is a strong argument for why we need those Clyde Lewis food buckets.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking, yes. But I talked to my father about that. He says, you know what? He said, that's BS. He says, there's so many backups and people paying attention to that. He goes, it would be really hard to someone to come in here from other countries and try to shut off our power grid.
Yeah, I think I think the real worry is a solar flare, which could happen at any moment. But well, you know what though? The Russians did recently hack us. Well, Trump says it was the Chinese, but literally every other human being on Earth says it was the Russians. Recently hacked us, and you know, we might be vulnerable to something like that if a foreign power can hack into our systems and shut off the lights
out. What supposedly did the Russians do to us? Hack us in what way?
Well, that's still being determined, just how badly it was. But apparently they were able to hack a lot of American companies. And, you know, if they're hacking into the systems of American companies on whom our economy relies, then that's very troubling. Also, if they're, you know, able to hack into the Pentagon. But we're still finding out. We're still learning a lot of this information as it sort of trickles out about, you know, exactly. But they do say this was the worst hacking that we've ever been a victim of in American history.
Yeah, I have to agree with you, though. If Mike Pence goes against Trump on January 6th and says that, you know, everything's okay and Joe Biden's our next president, he's all done, you know?
Yeah.
But he has to do it, though. You're right. He has to.
Yes. Yes. Absolutely. Absolutely.
If he does it, I guess you're right. That's the end of his career.
He's in a bad spot. I think that's why he wants to take that one last spin on Air Force Two.
Yeah. Well, might as well, right?
Might as well. I would. Absolutely.
You know, if you heard the world of wrestling, the Ric Flair's daughter, what's her name?
Charlotte.
Charlotte Flair, woo, is back in town. And if she was going to come back to town and do wrestling, they were going to put a belt on her, of course.
Yes. Well,
she wasn't going to come back just to be a minor star. She's a 12-time champion.
What I'm disturbed by, apparently, and Jenny and I are going to watch this at some point on the WWE Network, apparently Randy Orton murdered Bray Wyatt, lighting him on fire.
Yeah, but that's not true, though. It was taped ahead of time, I found out.
Oh,
and
it's scripted.
And they burned it. It wasn't really him. It was a dummy.
I'm glad you clarified that, EZG. Here I was.
Yeah, they interviewed him. And he knew him after. He says, I'm not dead.
Here I was thinking that Randy Orton had literally murdered Bray Wyatt. Whoa, this is a big relief.
But his girlfriend was back last night. I saw her on I don't have the channel anymore, but I saw the highlights, and she was in a swing set. And saying, you know, he might be back. So she's back from a little fiesta. She's back now. His girlfriend there, what's her name?
Alexa Bliss? Alexa Bliss.
Yeah, she's back, yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, I don't know if you heard that. They're getting desperate now for ratings. In a couple of weeks, they're going to bring back all the old farts and call it Legends Night.
I know. You don't like
funny,
it.
Though. I saw the list, and they said, oh, don't worry. More is added. And I didn't see Hulk Hogan on that list.
Oh,
I don't consider him a legend anymore because he got fired a while back. Remember?
I do remember that. Yes, yes.
I know he's back. He's back in the fold now, but I don't think he's back in the fold 100%.
Can you answer this question, EZG? Michael Alber is asking in the Facebook live chat. He says wrestling isn't real.
Yeah, that's what I've heard. But you can still get hurt, though.
You can still get hurt.
Yes, you can. Just ask a lot of these wrestlers, Triple H, and the list goes on and on.
Well, that's why Texas Mike had to retire.
True. But you know what? Ric Flair's daughter there, she had to take a step back, take a long vacation because she had trouble with one of her implants in her breast, I guess, exploded or something.
Oh, my goodness. Well, that's...
Yeah, so she had to get that fixed. So that's no joke.
That is no joke.
As we know, China had that problem too.
Yes.
I don't know if anything to result in her no longer being on this earth, but it probably did help.
Yeah, I think China. Well, she had some substance abuse issues.
No, not wrestlers.
Yeah, especially from that generation.
Yeah, Hulk Hogan was telling everybody to take his vitamins. I think he was taking steroids.
Oh, my goodness. Well, you'd know a little something about that. Now, wouldn't you, EZG? Come on. We all know that.
Oh, yeah, true. You're right.
You have the body of an Adonis, and we all know you're pharmaceutically enhanced.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I should probably cut back on that stuff. I've been told it's not good for me.
It'll shrivel you up, if you know what I mean. But,
I was watching. I was doing some investigation about the owner of AEW.
Investigation.
He's got they have a new show maybe on the network, and they asked him if he's going to go try to do his wrestling on tour. But he said not at the moment. So he's going to stay in Florida. Because you know it's an essential business.
Yes, Governor Ron DeSantis.
The governor over there in Florida loves wrestling, apparently.
Well, you know, he's tight with... I mean, you know, the McMahons are tight with Trump, and so...
About the owner of AEW, though, is he a fan of Trump?
Probably not. Well, he might be because he's a billionaire. I really don't know.
Yeah, he's right. Supposedly, he has more money than McMahon.
Yeah, the Khan family, because they also own, I forget what team they own. They own a major sports franchise, and they're billionaire. Yeah, they're actually far wealthier than Vince. That's why they've been able to actually make a go of it, and they're pulling bigger ratings than WWE right now.
Yeah, well, the WWE right now is having some problems with the... that's why they bring back Charlotte Flair and Alexa Bliss, and they got to bring back all those older guys from the retirement center there to try to get some ratings up. But the only bad news about that is that they won't be there the following week.
Right. Yeah, yeah.
They may get a good ratings one week, but... and then they this week on the SmackDown, they're going to have a cage match between Roman Reigns and Kevin Owens. But they don't really do that much anymore.
No.
But they need the ratings.
They do need the ratings. Yeah, they're getting...
They were saying,
crushed.
Too, on the web, World Wide Web, they were saying that the wrestling, maybe it's going to leave you a little past the PG, like they've been doing for years now, with all this violence about the Randy Orton, they're murdering a wrestler.
Yes, yes.
That's certainly not PG.
No. He's not the first one to light another wrestler on fire, though. Didn't Kane light somebody on fire once years ago?
He did, but I think they need to go a little push the envelope to get some ratings, don't you think?
Push the envelope, yes. So you want to see blood and guts is what you're saying. You want to see them...
Oh, no, but...
You want to see them bleed.
When the wrestling was really good back in the day, when they had Stone Cold and... Shawn Michaels and DX there and Triple H, and I'm not saying they got to get that down and low and disgusting, but I think people want to see a little more edgy wrestling, as they say.
I think so too.
There's a lot of money on the line, apparently.
Yes, there is.
McMahon signed some pretty big contracts.
That's what's...
And they were saying the USA Network is not impressed with the low ratings.
Well, would you be? I mean, that's what's keeping them thriving financially during... You know, WWE is actually, during their last... I follow the business more than I watch the actual shows,
right,
at this point. During their last quarterly earnings call, the last couple, actually, we found out during the pandemic, they're actually more profitable than ever because... doing these live shows in one location every week and not having to travel around the country and go to these different arenas, they're actually saving millions of dollars.
Yeah, but certainly isn't doing any good for their ratings, though.
Correct. Right. Their ratings are in the pooper, shall we say.
I think people are,
in the crap.
I'm not okay with
the toilet.
With the guys or ladies
in the commode
on the show. They're not
the porcelain bowl.
They're not good enough, I guess.
I guess not. No, it's just the writing is terrible. The writing is awful.
Well, whose fault is that? Isn't that Vince McMahon's? Because he had the final say,
yes,
of what goes on in the shows.
The buck stops with Vince. It's entirely possible that a 75-year-old man might be a little bit out of touch.
Yeah, well, he's had a good thing going years ago, but I don't know about it anymore.
Yeah.
A lot of people are saying that WWE is crap now.
Right. Yeah,
they're
turning
over to the AEW now. They said it's more edgy.
Yeah, yeah.
I guess Jim Ross was getting some bad press the other day because he was getting some blowback about some of his comments on the wrestlers.
Yeah, I guess he had
Maybe he's getting too long in the teeth.
No, he's still very good at what he does. If you watch any AEW and you hear his commentary, he's I think he's as sharp as ever. Him and Tony Schiavone, they're both very good, in my opinion.
Yeah, but they got to deal with that old retired guy Sting now.
Yeah, Sting is 62.
Some people aren't impressed with that old guy anymore. They're saying that his day is done.
Did you like him when he was like Surfer Sting with the blonde hair?
I don't remember that. 90s? I always remember he was a bad guy. The bat.
You really? Oh, you don't remember Sting before that? Before he turned into the pro? Oh, wow. Yeah, he was a man called Sting. He was a very happy guy, very bright, very happy, had the colorful face paint, had the blonde hair. Looked like a surfer.
Really? I don't remember that at all.
Yeah, you don't remember that? Wow.
And there was some people on the web saying that the Goldberg, the why he had short matches because they said he wasn't a good wrestler overall, period.
Yeah. Well, plus at his age, he gets winded.
Well, you think with Hogan too, he wasn't the best wrestler in the history of wrestling. His moves weren't the best. But he would run his mouth better than any wrestler. That's
Hogan,
why he was successful.
The thing about Hogan is Hogan actually could wrestle. It's just the American crowds didn't want to see that. They just wanted to see him pose and do the big moves. If you go on YouTube,
oh, really?
If you go on YouTube, Eric, and you look up Hogan's matches from Japan from the 80s and 90s, when Hogan was in Japan, he would wrestle a very different style. And I'm not saying he was Lou Thesz. But he actually could wrestle.
Oh, he used to wrestle in Japan? I didn't know that.
Yeah, yeah. Not a lot, but yeah, he did matches in Japan. And Hogan actually could wrestle. It's just the American crowds didn't want to see that from Hogan. They wanted to see him do the posing, wanted to see him body slam somebody and drop the leg.
I saw him wrestle the other day on the Facebook, and it was an old match when Andre the Giant was around. And I thought he only slammed him once when he was in WrestleMania, but he slammed him again.
Yeah, they made up a lot of that. Yeah, because Hogan and Andre had wrestled before WrestleMania 3, and also
they were friends.
And also,
but back when Andre got slammed at WrestleMania 3, which I think is the best WrestleMania in history of WrestleManias, he was on his way out as far as health wise, anyways. It was
Oh yeah, they had to pay him a lot of money to come back because he was already barely mobile. The match itself,
he died shortly after WrestleMania, didn't he? Die like a year or two later?
No, it was more like 5 or 6 years. But the match itself, Hogan versus Andre at WrestleMania 3, the match itself is actually terrible in my view. But all the hype, but all the hype they were able to build around it. I mean, when I was a kid, I mean that was like magic. That was.
Oh, I know. I went down to Concord to watch it on the one of those arenas there.
The closed
circuit television before they had it on pay per view.
Yeah, they used to do that at the Capitol Center. They'd have
paid like $10 or something.
Yeah,
was like the best WrestleMania in the history of WrestleMania. They had Randy Savage the other day against WrestleMania 3 against Ricky the Dragon Steamboat. Is that guy still around?
Oh yeah, Ricky Steamboat. Yeah, he's still around.
Yeah, that was one of the best matches in the history of WrestleMania.
Absolutely, it's fantastic.
Of course, now we know, he's gone now, and China's gone, and Elizabeth is gone, and oh boy. But Elizabeth had problems with drugs, too.
I haven't seen this yet, but I'm aware of it. Michael Alber says there's a great documentary on Netflix on Andre the Giant.
Oh, yeah, he was a hell of a wrestler. Back in the day, they said he could drink 100 beers.
I believe it, yeah. Sometimes,
I don't know if that's true or not, but
sometimes
if he was drinking that many beers, maybe was another reason why he's not around. Plus, he has some kind of disease too, a giant disease or something.
Yeah, I know. I don't remember exactly what it was with him. I know sometimes there's a thyroid thing that happens with people when they get that's what it is. Like Tony Robbins, the motivational guy. He's ridiculously tall, not as tall as Andre, but. But with him, it's like some sort of thyroid thing that causes people to get that big. Yeah, but I forget
if
exactly.
If you're drinking that many beers, though, in one setting, that's not good at all.
Yeah, probably not. Probably not good for his liver.
Well, look at Ric Flair. He almost died a couple of years ago, and he came out that he was a big-time alcoholic.
Yeah, he did almost die. Yeah,
but a lot of those guys drink and do drugs and sex, drugs, and rock and roll in the world of wrestling.
Mm-hmm.
Why a lot of the guys aren't around anymore.
Michael Albert says pituitary gland. That's what I was thinking of, not thyroid.
Yeah,
pituitary.
Yeah.
Yep. Makes
sense. All right, well, I'll let you go. The show's going to wrap it up soon, so we'll talk to you tomorrow for my entertainment report.
All right, EZG. We'll talk to you then. Take care. EZG, Eric Gagnon. Yes, he'll be calling tomorrow at 5 p.m. with the final entertainment report of 2020 here on Matt Connerton Unleashed. Very exciting. Very exciting. Fajona Davis is in the Facebook live chat, enjoying the music I was playing earlier. Very nice. Um,
Let's see. Just want to make sure we don't miss anybody in here. Yep, everybody's talking about the stimulus. Bobby says it's not a very stimulating package, LOL. Yeah, I mean, but, you know, hey, that whopping $600 a week, I'm sure, you know, that really goes a long way. Michael Albert says, now, this is regarding Al Gore, if Al Gore had been president. Afghanistan would have happened. That's where Al Qaeda was. Iraq would not have happened with Gore. So Iraq would not have happened, but Afghanistan would have because of... I thought Al Qaeda was in Mexico. I'm kidding. Of course, he then clarifies he meant Al-Qaeda. The autocorrect made it Qaeda. Oh, boy. Angela says, though, Al Qaeda sounded good. Yes, it does sound... That sounds delicious. I think Bobby Champagne agrees. Yep. Eric Street, who is a top fan, says a meatball quesadilla sounds good if they even exist. That does sound good. Yeah. Bobby says, I used to make a Mexican pizza with refried beans and ground beef and four types of cheeses. Yum. That does sound good. That does sound good. Let's see. So, Tom had said something about something he disagreed. Oh, Michael Albert says, doesn't McMahon own all of it? No. There's other companies other than WWE. You know, there's AEW, which was started by the Khan family, who they actually have more money than Vince, and they're doing very well against Vince. And of course, you've got Impact Wrestling in Canada, which has somewhat of a presence. Tom says, why are we talking about wrestling? These guys are all millionaires. To hell with those guys. They're not all millionaires. Michael Albert says wrestlers hardly make any money and end up with wrecked bodies. That's why the successful ones move to acting, like Dwayne Johnson. Absolutely. Brian Mackey says, I heard Cyndi Lauper was involved in the Andre the Giant MGMT. Yeah, Cyndi Lauper got involved in wrestling for a bit. Michael Albert says, Andre died of an enlarged heart, I believe. Ah, yes. I think that's what killed the Grinch, too, if I'm not mistaken, because his heart, like, increased, you know, to two times the size. Let's see. Let me give the numbers again. We're actually almost out of show, but if you want to get in with a call before we wrap up, 603-250-6007, 603-250-6007. And, of course, you can... text me at 617-917-4476, tweet me at Matt Connerton, or send an email to matt@mattconnerton.com. I wanted to, let's see. Yeah, I'd shared this out earlier. Pat Robertson, of all people, had some words for Trump. Even Pat Robertson apparently believes that Trump is living in an alternate reality. Listen to this.
With all his talent and the ability to raise money and draw large crowds, the president still lives in an alternate reality. He really does. People say, well, he lies about this, that, and the other. But no, he isn't lying. To him, that's the truth. He had the biggest crowd on Inauguration Day. He had more people than ever. He was the most popular people. He saved NBC, but with The Apprentice. You know, you go down the line of things that really aren't true, and, you know, people kept pointing to them. But because they loved him so much and he was so strong for the evangelicals were with him all the way. But there was something about him that was good, that God placed him in that office for the time. He's done a marvelous job for the economy. But at the same time, he is very erratic, and he He's fired people, and he's fought people, and he's insulted people, and it keeps going down the line. So it's a mixed bag, and I think it would be well to say you've had your day, and it's time to move on.
Wow. Pat Robertson from the 700 Club, apparently some tough love, because he clearly does love and adore President Trump, but but apparently would like for Trump to move on. Also, by the way, another character in this tragic comedy of the Trump administration, Bill Barr. You know, we talked on the show last week about how Bill Barr had told the Associated Press that, I think it was last week or the week before, Bill Barr had told the Associated Press that there's no evidence of widespread voter fraud. They did turn up, by the way. There's more details that have surfaced. They did turn up an incident of voter fraud in Pennsylvania. Turned out it was a Republican voting for Trump who committed the voter fraud. But that aside, so there you go. Voter fraud is real, apparently. The Republicans were right. They found a Republican in Pennsylvania committing voter fraud. Anyway, so Bill Barr told the Associated Press that they were not investigating voter fraud because he could find no evidence of widespread voter fraud, certainly not on a scale that would have affected the election. And then shortly thereafter, next thing you know, Bill Barr is...
We're all just...
Sorry about that. Next thing you know, Bill Barr is a little spontaneous audio. Bill Barr is writing a love letter of a resignation letter to President Trump. And of course, it was announced that Barr would be gone. What is it? Tomorrow? Is tomorrow the last day of Bill Barr? So now Bill Barr is probably undid whatever goodwill he had through that wonderful letter. I even performed a very nice dramatic reading of the letter of resignation to Trump, because then he went ahead and started contradicting Trump on all kinds of things. So this is from CNN.com. Bill Barr says no need for special counsels to investigate election or Hunter Biden. You know, Hunter Biden, of course, this, you know, in 2016, it was all about, you know, her emails and Benghazi. This year, it's been all about Burisma and Hunter Biden, and none of that sticks, just as her emails and Benghazi didn't really stick. But CNN says Attorney General William Barr yesterday rejected several of President Trump's inflammatory and unfounded statements regarding the presidential election, saying at a news conference that he doesn't plan to appoint a special counsel to investigate President-elect Joe Biden's son, Hunter, or the election. Quote, if I thought a special counsel at this stage was a right tool and was appropriate, I would name one, but I haven't, and I'm not going to, unquote, Barr said in response to a question on the presidential election. He said that widespread fraud was not found in this election. Barr also roundly rejected suggestions from the president's supporters in recent days, who've called for the U.S. government to seize voting machines. Barr said, quote, I see no basis for seizure of machines by the federal government, unquote. It was Barr's last major news conference leading the Justice Department under Trump, and highlighted how much the attorney has split from a president to whom he remained close until recent weeks. Trump has inquired about the need for special investigations of Hunter Biden and on so-called voting fraud, and he continues to entertain and distribute unfounded theories that the presidential election was stolen from him. So Barr said, quote, there is fraud, unfortunately, in most elections. I think we're too tolerant of it, unquote. But in this election, Barr said, he stands by the finding that there was no systemic or broad-based fraud, a finding the president refuses to admit. On the Hunter Biden financial investigation, which the Biden transition acknowledged recently and Barr had kept quiet during the election season, and that, by the way, was part of what initially had infuriated Trump with Barr, was even before the comments that Barr had made to the AP last week or the week before,
when it was revealed that there was an investigation of Hunter Biden that was taking place during the campaign, but apparently William Barr didn't want that to be politicized. So he didn't make that public, which apparently Trump was extremely unhappy about. So the attorney general gave a similar answer that there is no need for him to take special steps to protect the investigation. Quote, to the extent there's an investigation, I think it's being handled responsibly and professionally currently within the department. And to this point, I have not seen a reason to appoint a special counsel, and I have no plan to do so before I leave, unquote, Barr said when asked about Hunter Biden, federal prosecutors, and the IRS investigations are conducting the probe. And Hunter Biden has not been charged with any crime. Barr's comments came after announcing new criminal charges against an alleged bomb maker in the 1988 terrorist bombing of the Pan Am Flight 103 over Lockerbie, Scotland, which is just commonly referred to in shorthand as the Lockerbie bombing. So that was the main point, by the way. So the whole point of this press briefing, it was not for Barr to come out and specifically just go through a list of things that he disagrees with Trump on, or talk about, you know, I'm not going to do this, I'm not going to do that because I don't see a reason to. The main thing was about the Lockerbie bombing, but then he's being asked by the media these other questions, and you know, and he's answering them. Skipping down, following the announcement, reporters asked Barr about a range of other controversial issues involving the Justice Department. In response to other questions, Barr explained why he appointed U.S. Attorney John Durham as special counsel to investigate the origins of the Russia probe by the FBI in 2016. Barr said, quote, I wanted to provide him and his team with insurance that they'd be able to finish their work, unquote, likely during the Biden administration. He said they were making good progress and declined to discuss any conclusions. He also declined to respond when asked if a president could pardon himself, another topic of much debate in legal circles as the Trump presidency nears its end. Barr said, quote, off the top of my head, I'm not going to opine on a constitutional issue as far as the pardon power goes, unquote. On the SolarWinds cyber attack that affected several agencies in the U.S. government, Barr said, quote, it certainly appears to be the Russians, unquote. Barr added that he agreed with U.S. Secretary of State Mike Pompeo on this conclusion, because Pompeo also, like I said earlier, as far as saying it was not the Russians and blaming the Chinese, Trump is literally the only person I can think of who has said that it wasn't the Russians, it was the Chinese. Trump over the weekend downplayed the massive cyber attack on the U.S. federal government agencies and contradicted Pompeo's statement, saying without evidence that the attack may have come from China. So there you go. Or it might have been a 400-pound guy sitting on the edge of his bed. Remember that? Which I suppose it could have been. We're going to run out of time, but by the way, speaking of investigations, America's mayor, that crazy old man himself, Rudy Giuliani, CNBC.com reporting, Trump lawyer Rudy Giuliani blasts investigators as federal probe heats up. Some key points from this, because we are out of time. President Donald Trump's personal lawyer, Rudy Giuliani, lashed out against federal prosecutors investigating him. Giuliani suggested they are acting as, quote, secret police and serving the political interests of President-elect Joe Biden. Giuliani is being investigated by prosecutors in the office of the U.S. Attorney for Manhattan. He once held that same top post. Oh, my goodness. So we'll see where that goes. But Rudy might be in some trouble. let's see. We'll take one last look at the Facebook here. Before we go, Bobby Champagne said, I heard something about ringing a bell at 6 p.m. on Christmas Day. I guess that they are trying to get the whole world to do it at the same time.
Well, that's interesting. Michael Albert says, the Grinch didn't hate Christmas. He didn't like people. Rocky Huber says, I'm for the Grinch. Think he was bullied as a kid and bullied as an adult. Then he just ruined everyone's Christmas. I see EZG as being the next Grinch. Oh my goodness. Well, I hope not. I hope EZG is not the next, not the next Grinch. That would be, terrible. All right. Well, we are about out of time, so we will, we'll conclude with that. I want to thank you all, and remember, tomorrow here on the show, we will be joined in the 5 o'clock hour. Sorry, I was just looking at some comments, but we'll have to save those. Tomorrow we'll be joined in the 5 o'clock hour by EZG with his entertainment report, and won't that be exciting, my friends? Let's get those Amanda McCarthy tour dates. If you missed any part of today's show, it'll be up in just a little bit at WMNHradio.org. And thank you all. Thank you to EZG for calling earlier, as well as Dave Ridley, and prayers for Daryl W. Perry. Thank you to everybody in the Facebook live chat. And I mentioned Lauren Mayer earlier. I'm not going to play the Penn song. I'm going to play something new from her to close out today's show as we conclude this edition of Matt Connerton Unleashed. And remember, if you missed any part of it, it will be up in just a little bit at WMNHradio.org. And that's it for me for now. I will talk at y'all a little bit later. Bye, everybody.